I used to subscribe to this journal called Leadership Quarterly, and it was kind of geared toward the megachurch pastor crowd, but I enjoyed the articles about a church's vision and mission. And I got to tell you, the cartoons alone were worth the $6.95 cover price, you know. And one of the articles I remember was called "Everyone Thinks Their Church is Friendly." And it was about the dangers of churches becoming too inwardly focused. And the writer said, if you ask anyone in your church if your church is a friendly church, they're going to say, oh yeah, of course our church is a friendly church. But the true answer to that question comes when you ask a person who is visiting your church for the first time, when a stranger comes into the church. And then, of course, the article goes on to talk about what you can do to make your church a more friendly, welcoming place. Now, there have been all sorts of variations of this article written in books and other periodicals, and it's a common issue in churches. How do we welcome the other, the stranger, or the alien, to use Paul's language? It was definitely a problem in the early church. It was an issue in the early church. And in this letter to the church in Ephesus that Mary read part of, Paul is addressing an old culture clash between the Jewish Christians and people who had come to the Christian faith who were Gentiles or Greco-Roman in their culture. And so in the book of Acts and some of Paul's earlier writings, we read about Jewish Christians who were, they were insisting that non-Jewish Christians, that Gentiles, convert over to Judaism in order to become a part of the fellowship. And so what they were doing was insisting that Gentiles be circumcised in order to become a part of the fellowship. Now get your head wrapped around that one for a second, okay? Because how many of the Gentiles do you think were raising their hands saying, oh, that sounds like a terrific idea. Let's do that, you know? Not too many people would be doing that. So Paul and the other apostles had to say, listen, you don't have to convert to Judaism to be a follower of Christ. Yes, Jesus was a Jewish teacher. Yes, he was a prophet. But he came to unite people, not to keep people divided. And of course, there was grumbling on both sides. People, but finally the church welcomed Jews and Gentiles alike into the fellowship. And then they went out into the world and brought others who didn't fit any of those categories into fellowship. So, as Paul writes, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundations of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. So one of the lessons that the church is supposed to take home is don't exclude or neglect people who may seem like outsiders. Now, I would love to say that once the church heard this message, they never had any problems again in the history of the church with excluding people. But we know a little bit different, don't we? In fact, it's our nature to be suspicious of the other. It's in our nature to fear or even loathe people whose differences set them apart from the community norm. Now, it wasn't that long ago in the history of our own country that blacks were not welcome in white churches. Now, I know we'd like to say that in this post-civil rights era that we've somehow moved beyond the mistrust and the prejudices of the past, but the church is still one of the most segregated places in our country today. And honestly, after what happened at Mother Emanuel Church last month, I wouldn't hold it against the members of any African-American congregation for looking at me with suspicion if I visited their church unannounced. Now notice that when I said that the church is one of the most segregated places, I didn't say racially segregated, because we're definitely that. But we're segregated in so many other ways too, right? Folk wisdom tells us that birds of a feather flock together, And nowhere is that more evident than in the church. Okay? Because, you know, go church shopping sometime. No, wait, don't go church. I'd really like you to be here. Let's rephrase that. If you ever do go church shopping, you'll find that on any given Sunday, in any given town, you can find churches that consist mainly of wealthy, influential people. Or you can find churches that consist mostly of poor people. You can find churches that are made up of politically or socially conservative or liberal people. You can find churches that mostly have young people, and then you have others that have mostly older people. Churches that are mostly gay, churches that are mostly straight. Sometimes the dividing line is in worship style. You know, sometimes it's formal versus informal. The list goes on, and there are, of course, exceptions to that rule, but most churches that are very intentional about their commitment to be a church for all people are the ones that are an exception to the rule. Now, as much as I sometimes balk at the label, we are what's part of a church called the Mainline Protestant Church. We're in the same category and share kinship with people like the American Baptists, the Lutherans, Methodists, most Presbyterians, United Church of Christ, Episcopalians. And some of the characteristics of mainline Protestant churches are classic church architecture. You know, the little arches here. We have candles. We have stained glass. We have a bell tower. We ring the bell. And they also, we tend to have more traditional worship. And when I say traditional, I mean pretty much the way it was during its peak years during the 50s and 60s. We tend to be a little more liturgical. In other words, we have rituals like the Lord's Prayer, communion, doxology, responsive readings, and we tend to observe events in the common church calendar. So we observe high holy days in the church, as well as Lent and Advent and World Communion Sunday and things like that. We've also declined in numbers over the years too. And we struggle to make ends meet as our buildings get older and more difficult to maintain. And we also tend to have a majority of older people on Sunday mornings. Now, here's a little misconception that I want to clear up for you, okay? I want to share this misconception with you before you think that I'm trying to dampen your spirits being Dr. Doom here this morning. There is a misconception that because we're mainline Protestants, because we are who we are, that somehow we're not attractive to younger people. That's not true at all, because there have been some really good studies by credible places like the Alban Institute and the Pew Research Foundation that says younger people aren't necessarily attractive just to the modern contemporary churches with all the bells and whistles that come with them. They are attracted to churches that are authentic, that are reliable, that are genuine, that are welcoming. They're attracted to churches that are trustworthy and loving and faithful to the heart of the good news of Jesus. In fact, one of the most talked about and up-and-coming churches in the emerging church movement is a congregation in Denver, Colorado called the House for All Sinners and Saints. And their pastor's name is Nadia Boltz-Weber. This is Nadia Boltz-Weber. She is a spiky-haired, tattooed, middle-aged woman who is just full of energy, and she's also an ordained Lutheran minister. She grew up in a very conservative Church of Christ movement where there was a lot of rules and behavioral norms and things like that that she just balked against. But she always felt the presence of God. She never felt like she was abandoned by God. She always felt like God was with her. And during a time in her life when she was struggling with addiction and making ends meet as a stand-up comedian, she received this call to ministry. She got on a path to sobriety. She went to seminary, got ordained, and then started this church in Denver with 8 people in her living room. And these 8 people were what most folks in mainstream Protestant churches would consider outsiders, aliens, and exiles. We're talking people just like Nadia, people who have tattoos, living on the edge of what polite conservative society would call normal. And the funny thing is that these folks here at this church for sinners and saints, is that their faith and their practice is very traditional. It's very liturgical. Nadia had an interview with Krista Tippett on a show called On Being, and she said, you know, I feel strongly that if you have to, you have to be deeply rooted in tradition in order to innovate with integrity. So, for example, we celebrate the Easter Vigil, where you start with a new fire and you light it, and you have this Paschal candle, and you parade it in chanting, and we have these baptisms, and we have the Eucharist, and it's like amazing. And then we end it. When it's done, we have a huge dance party, because we feel nothing says he is risen like a chocolate fountain in the baptismal font. So we are taking these traditions and we're living them out, and we're tweaking them in ways that are super meaningful or funny or relevant to us. Sounds pretty authentic, doesn't it? She said, and we were excited because we were, here's the thing, is even a church like Nadia's struggles with welcoming, okay? They struggle with being a welcoming community. And so Nadia, in this interview with Krista Tippett, is telling a story about when she preached in front of 10,000 people at a sunrise service in Red Rocks, Colorado. And so the Denver Post comes along, and they run this full front page story on their religious section about this service and Nadia's struggling little church of about 45 people, grungy, hip, young adult people. And the next week, her church had twice the number of people as the week before. And she said, you know, we were excited about this because we were really struggling to grow. But what happened was, it was like the wrong kind of people came. I mean, it was the wrong kind of different for us. You know, some churches might freak out if a drag queen shows up, but these were like, advance the slide here, Connor. These were like people in dockers and blue shirts. They looked like bankers, you know? And I freaked out. She thought, these people could show up at any mainline Protestant church in town and see a room full of people that looked just like them. So why are they coming to her church? They were saying, oh, this church is so neat, it's so cute, it's so creative. And Nadia thought, no, man, you are ruining our thing. You're messing it up. Nadia's church eventually ended up moving into a new building. They had to move out of their old building, and so they moved into a new building. And it was in the stately historic neighborhood, unlike the grungy hipster neighborhood that they came from. And you know what? Sure enough, all those people in dockers followed them right over to this new building. And at first, they weren't too sure what to do about this. And so Nadia turned to one of her deacons and she says, you know, we got to get the hell out of this neighborhood because it's attracting the wrong element. And so she called on one of her friends who had a similar church in St. Paul, Minnesota, and she called him and said, dude, have you ever had normal people take over your church? And you know, she was expecting some sympathy from this guy, but he reminded her that one of the founding principles of All Sinners and Saints was radical hospitality and welcoming the alien, the stranger. And he said, yeah, you know, you guys are really good at welcoming the stranger when it's a young transgender kid. But sometimes the stranger looks like your mom and your dad. Go ahead and advance the slide. Hence the bulletin cover this week. And she said, "You're supposed to be my friend," and hung up on him. But then she had this epiphany that turned her heart of stone back into a heart of flesh and spirit. So she gathered some of her folks from her church together, and she confessed her sin of exclusion to them. And one of her members said, "Look, as that transgendered young kid who was welcomed into this community, I just want to go on record as saying I'm glad there's people who look like my mom and dad here, because they love me in ways my mom and dad can't." To quote the final verse of our scripture this morning, in Christ, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also were built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God.
Thank you.